The Lord, the word of the Lord from Isaiah chapter 40.
Faith to believe God's word is the very essence of receiving the promises that he says we can have. Isaiah 40 is going to list some promises for us. And we know that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So, let's hear the word of the Lord. Would you stand for the reading of God's word? To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes, look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls forth each of them by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God. He's the creator of the ends of the earth, and he will not grow tired or weary. His understanding, no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary. He increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles, and they will run and not get weary, and they will walk and not faint. Pray with me. Father, we are so grateful to be here this morning. Such an amazing grace and blessing to meet with your people and to hear your word and to just embrace all the benefits of being a part of the community of Christ. I pray, Father, that you would give us the faith that will listen to your word. I pray that we won't take it for granted. I pray that you'd help us to concentrate as Brother Jeff shares truth with us. I pray that you would change our hearts and change our minds and pick up those who are weary and tired. You promise to us that through your word, you will give us everything we need to be victorious and to run and to soar. And so we ask you for that promise, and we believe that you, the everlasting God, that you are able and you are willing and you care so deeply for us, and you want to keep all these promises to us. And we thank you and praise you for it. Amen.
Heavenly host, praise Father.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. You can be seated. And thank you, Gregory, for being willing to do whatever it was I wanted to be wanted done. He was the man.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. It's wonderful to see you this morning. It's good to be back. I want to say well done to Brother Dave on his preaching debut last week. Appreciate the perspective and the encouragement. And we appreciate Brother David in so many ways, in the way that he has served the Lord through this church. Since he was a little bitty boy, I think he joined the choir when he was about 12 years old, something like that. And we're thankful for him. A couple of things I want to share with you. Remember, next Sunday, our candidate for youth pastor, a pastor of youth and family life, will be here Friday or Saturday, working that out with the youth leaders right now. The teens will meet with them. And then just for a time to get to know one another and just to fellowship and enjoy their time. It isn't going to be anything very formal, but just to get to know one another. And then they will meet with the deacons Saturday evening. Caleb will preach Sunday morning. And then we'll have lunch, and then we'll come back in here and vote, just like we did with Cal and Cassie. So beginning to learn this process. So I hope that you will be here and be praying for them and for our church. Cal and Cassie's first Sunday will be the 8th, so not next week, but the week after that will be their first Sunday here. They may need help moving. Don't know the details about that yet, but when the time comes, I hope that you will be able to help move them from Stillwater. I want to give you a brief report about the National Convention, where we were last week. First of all, so proud and thankful for Brother Keith Burden, who did a great job preaching in the Monday night service and challenging us from the Gospel of Matthew, how to forgive one another and to reconcile, and how we find victory through that, through the peace that that Jesus gives, not only between us and God, but between brothers and sisters as well. So we're all proud of him and thankful for him. The preaching was very good at the National Convention this year, and we were very encouraged by it. The worship was great. It was just good to be with our folks. We didn't have a convention last year because of COVID, and so there was a real atmosphere of warmth. People were just ready to see one another, ready to hug one another's necks a little bit longer, and it was really good to be with our folks. I know that our Truth and Peace kids, we had 6 of our students go to Truth and Peace, and so they spent a week and a half in leadership training at Randall, they've testified to me already that their faith and their walk with the Lord was really deepened, and they learned some things. One of the things they did was they left their phones somewhere else, and it gave them an opportunity to listen. One of the practices was solitude. Find a place where there's nobody else, no distractions, no phone, nothing but you and God's Word. And their testimony is, and here in the next few weeks, The teens have had a wonderful summer, and God is doing great things in our youth group right now. They have a lot of testimonies about camp and mission trip with Morgan going to Chicago, and then with Truth and Peace. And you need to be praying and giving thanks for what God is doing in our students' lives. And I'm expecting that to spread to the rest of us, right? In the excitement, the fire that our students are experiencing. But the testimony that I've heard is that in this time of solitude, I think it was a couple of hours, I don't know how long, it was at least a couple of hours, it went by like that. And for some of them, that was their favorite part of the whole thing. Not having your phone, having only your Bible, and being in a place of solitude and quiet, just with them and the Lord. So the teens had a great week, had a great 2 or 3 weeks. They served at the National Convention in various capacities, helping with children's classes and with worship and everything else. And we're very thankful and proud of them and for all of them, what the Lord is doing. I want to share with you 2 resolutions that came out of our national convention. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but these were both passed unanimously. And typically a resolution from an association meeting like this is going to speak to some issue that is prominent in the culture at that time. So these two resolutions have to do with the LGBTQ issues. Of course, I've been preaching about that. And then the race issues as well, and how Christians should think about the solution to racism, identifying the problems and coming up with a solution to that. Let me just read a couple of paragraphs from these. First, this is Resolution 1. Again, this came from the Commission for Theological Integrity, and it was passed unanimously by the body. It talks about a biblical view of creation and sexuality, and then it says, therefore, be it resolved that Free Will Baptists recommit themselves to teach a model, a biblical model and biblical understanding of sexuality and gender in their families and churches, seeking to equip church members and leaders to help them remain faithful to the biblical teaching. We've been doing that here just in the last couple of months. Be it further resolved that we seek to minister with compassion, to minister with compassion to those sincerely struggling with confusion in the areas of sexuality and gender, recognizing them to be image bearers with inherent worth and dignity. There's more to the resolution, but those were the most salient points for this morning. Resolution 2 has to do with race relations. It says, we reaffirm, the resolution cited and passed in 1965. So this is the midst of the civil rights issues that were going on in the 60s. The 1965 annual session of National Association of Free Will Baptists affirming back in 1965 that all persons should equally enjoy those freedoms and privileges intended by God from creation, taught in the Bible, and provided by the Constitution of the United States of America. That the Church of Jesus Christ must recognize the dignity of every person as a creation of God and must actively seek ways to bring that person into a right relationship with God, regardless of race or national origin. And that the transformation of mankind through faith in Jesus Christ is the greatest instrument available to break down prejudices and cause justice to prevail. And whereas that reaffirmation and resolution cited a resolution from the 1995, so 65-95 annual session of the National Association of Free Will Baptists, affirming that because all people are created in the image of God, 126, all people have descended through one blood from Adam, Acts 17:26, and God desires for all people to be saved, 2 Peter 3:9. The body resolved to condemn racism in any form and to pledge and to proclaim the gospel freely to all men. Therefore, be it resolved that this body, so 2021, maintain these commitments and its roots and root its proclamation, witness and efforts toward racial equality. So to root these efforts toward racial equality in language, thought forms, and understandings of justice that emerge from the Holy Scripture, rather than in language, thought forms, and understandings of justice that emerge from secular philosophical and sociological theory, such as critical race theory and intersectionality. Be it further resolved that this body reaffirm that Scripture clearly defines every human being as created in the image and likeness of God, guilty of sin as a departure from God, by all humanity, and called to salvation as the only deliverance from sin through the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so that second resolution focuses on this fact, that everything we need in terms of resources to know that racism is a sin and the way that people might be reconciled, it's all found right here in God's Word. And it is unnecessary. It's not to say that other people can't recognize things through other means. That is not the point. But everything we need is right here. And if we will rightly understand the Word of God and preach the Word of God and people will receive the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, then these issues of racism will go away because we have sufficient resources in the Word of God. All right, so those are the resolutions. It was a great convention. I appreciate you all generously sending us. And one other announcement, then I want us to read a scripture and then pray. Many of you know Sister Wanda Key very well. They've been longtime members of the church, haven't been able to be active in the church for a while. She and Mays are in their 90s. But Wanda is in the nursing home in Claremore, and she is on hospice now. She fell 2 or 3 weeks ago and has gone downhill since then. So be praying for Mays and Wanda and Karen and Andrea and Marcia and the rest, Mark, and the rest of the family. Okay, we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer here in just a moment. And before we do that, I want to read another scripture to you. One of the things that we pray in the Lord's Prayer is, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And a discipline of the Christian life ought to be confessing our sins, to reflecting upon the life that we've lived today and this week and this month and this year, and how God's Spirit might be speaking to me in ways that I need to repent and to confess, and for God's Spirit to give me the grace to do better. So I want to read Psalm 32, verses 1 through 5. I asked Marion to go ahead and begin playing that next song. We're going to sing about the glorious day that's coming. But listen to David's testimony, and I'm going to have Marion play for just a moment when I finish reading this. And I want you this morning to ask God to shine light into your heart. If there be any sin that I've been hiding, ignoring, unconfessed, that God's light would shine upon it by His Word and by His Spirit, and to spend a moment confessing and turning to the Lord in repentance. David says, "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the one to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit." That is, they're not lying about it to themselves or anyone else. "When I declared not my sin, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to thee. I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord. Then thou didst forgive the guilt of my sin." Would you bow your heads with me as we turn our hearts to the Lord in confession and repentance, and take someone's hand, and we will pray the Lord's Prayer in just a moment. Self-deception is so easy, we fall into it so quickly. And Lord, we know that it is your will that we be sanctified, made holy by your grace, by the power of the Spirit, by the blood of your Son. So we pray for your forgiveness. Give us wisdom to see the ways that we have gone wrong, and put us on the right path pray for Sister Wanda and for Brother Mays, that you would give them grace and that you would give them comfort as they walk together through this dark valley. That they would find comfort from their children, that you would give comfort to their children and grandchildren and their family. We know that you're able to do all these things because you are our Father, which art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Sing this wondrous story.
He's coming.
head back to Children's Church at this time. Learn a lot, young people. Counting on it. Let's sing again.
Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. The title of the message is Tell It Like It Is. The point of this message is that we will win the world by announcing the word to the world. And that word is the gospel. I want to begin by reading our text, verse 1 through 11. We'll come back to verse 20 and following later on in the message, because it's a part of this proclamation. I'm reading this from the New American Standard Bible. I like the way that it rendered this passage. This is the New American Standard Bible, the 2020 revision. But I want you to hear the word of the Lord as Paul writes to the Corinthians, "Now I make known to you, brothers and sisters, I make known to you the gospel which I preached to you." Literally, "the gospel which I gospeled to you, which you also received, in which you stand, by which you also are saved," or are being saved, "if you hold firmly to the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain or believed to no purpose. For I handed down to you as of first importance, of primary importance, what I also received." I received this. Namely, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that He appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. After that, He appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time. Now, most of them remain until now. They're still alive. Some have fallen asleep. Then He appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, He appeared to me also. For I am the least of the apostles, not fit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And His grace toward me did not prove vain, but I labored even more than all of them. Yet not I, don't misunderstand, but it was the grace of God within me. Whether then it was I or whether it was they, so we preached, and so you believed. Our Father in heaven, we are thankful for the gospel. It's the power of God unto salvation for all who believe. And we pray, Lord, that you would help us to know the gospel, to receive it, to announce it, to embrace it all the way home. I pray if there are some here who have not embraced the gospel as it is, truly and fully, that today would be the day that they would come home, that they would have their sins forgiven. In Jesus' name and for His sake, amen. There are 3 points, the message today. The first is the Word. The second is the whole Word, or the whole gospel. And the last is the warning in the Word. The Word. I want us to think about the Word specifically, gospel. What does gospel mean? In Greek, it's euangelion. That's two words together there, really. Can you say that? Euangelion. Euangelion. That's the Greek word for gospel. I have an announcement. Now, when I say that, it gets people's attention. Is he resigning? What's going on here? Okay, when someone says to you, "I have some news to tell you," when we know that it's an announcement, it gets our attention just like that. People's heads look up. What? This is important. He's about to say something important. Let's pay attention. Let's listen up. I remember when I announced my call to preach to Debbie and Keith. I know I've shared this before. We had gone down to the lake for the weekend. It was about time to go home. And at the last minute, I announced to Keith and Debbie. We sat them down and said, "We have some news." And don't you know that got their attention? We'd been married a month. And Debbie had a look of horror on. I'll never forget it. I mean, it's like it happened yesterday. But when someone says, "I have news to announce," it grabs our attention. This is what the gospel is. It's announcing news. It's announcing news. Now, the subject of this chapter is resurrection, but the subject of this section is the gospel. Paul says, "I made known to you the gospel which I gospeled," the good news which I good newsed to you. What does that mean? This is kind of corny, but let's talk about you. E-U, let's talk about you. We see this show up in our world in different places, right? What is a eulogy? E-U-L-O-G-Y. A eulogy is a good word. Don't speak ill of the dead. It means at the funeral you stand up and you say something good about the person. Logos is word. You, logos, eulogy, a good word. Eugene, any Eugenes here? The gene, we get genesis or genetics, has to do with your birth. And so Eugene means someone of noble birth, someone of good birth. What is a euphemism? Euphemia is a Greek word for to speak or to say. So you is a good word or a good speaking. There's something that you don't want to say it just like it is, and so you use a good word. You use a euphemism to describe it. Euthanasia. If you all watch the, I don't remember if it's, which one of the comic companies, DC or what's the other one? Marvel. We've seen some of these. Thanos is a character. Thanatos means death. Thanasia, euthanasia, good death. That's not really what it is, okay? But that's the idea. Euphoria. Pharaoh means to carry something in Greek. So euphoria, originally it meant you were sick and now you've taken some medication and you feel better. So it means to carry a good feeling. Eucharist, the center of our worship. Eucharist, good greeting, or means literally to give thanksgiving. So we have this embedded, euangelion, a good, what is the angelion? Well, we get our word angel from it. Angelos, a message. So a euangelion, it means a good message. A good message that you announce. That you announce. Romans 10, how beautiful are the feet of one who brings good news, who has come into our community and who has announced to everybody something good. Isn't it good to hear good news? Man, we hear bad news all of the time. You turn on the TV, bad news, bad news, bad news. Intentionally trying to inflame our passions, to hate one another and to think the world is falling apart, to make us afraid and to make us fall apart. But there is good news, the gospel, good news. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. It's great to get some good news every now and then. Thank God the good news is indestructible and eternal. It's always here. So the gospel is an announcement. An announcement. This is before the internet, okay, where you don't post something on Facebook. You actually have to go somewhere. Think about the Emancipation Proclamation. It is an announcing of something that has taken place. And the news began to spread from Washington throughout the country. The announcement, you have been freed from slavery. This is what has been done. This is the point. A gospel, a good newsing, means this is what has happened, and you better learn to live with it, because this is just the way it is. So this person, who would come into the middle of the town and make this announcement? Sometimes we call it a town crier, but the word is a herald. We have a Christmas song, Hark the Herald angels sing. That means that they have come to announce something. Remember, there were shepherds abiding in the fields by night, watching over their sheep. In Luke chapter 2, verse 9 says, and an angel, an angelos of the Lord, appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with fear. And the angelos, the angel, said to them, don't be afraid. Well, what are you doing here? Well, behold, I bring you euangelizomai. I am evangelizing you. I'm good newsing you. I have good news. The angel came from heaven to make an announcement. Well, what was that announcement? A good news of great joy, which will come to all the people. What is that news? For unto you is born this day in the city of David, what? A Savior. I'm announcing salvation, who is Christ the Lord. In order to be saved, you have to confess Christ is Lord. That is the idea there. I want you to think about the angel. This is the way the story begins. Angels bringing good news. This is the way the story of Jesus begins. It's good news to Mary and Joseph, to shepherds. And when Paul and Peter and Andrew and the apostles and all of them go out, they're missionaries. And this is what they think that they're doing as well. They were going into the world, just as the angels had announced to the world, they were going out into the world to announce good news. The world's reaction. Remember Paul going to the synagogue, getting kicked out. The world's reaction did not change the truth of the announcement. One iota. Their response could not change the truth of the announcement. This is the message. This is the truth about what has happened. You cannot change it. You cannot undo it. It is the good news, the euangelion. That's what we have received. The Bible says you are saved when you believe the message. Have you heard the message? You believe it? You confess it. I believe it. Jesus is Lord. So if the message came to a hamlet in the Roman Empire, and the herald would come into the middle of the town and cry out, Octavian Augustus is Caesar, is Lord. There's been a change in leadership, and you better get used to it. It doesn't matter if you like it or not. He's still Caesar. He is still Lord. The response of the people could not change the fact of the message. They could rebel against it. They could try to undo it, try to subvert it, or they could bow down before it and get used to it. It is what it is. And here, it is the good news. What is the good news? I remember when I was a kid in kids' church at West Tulsa. I'll never forget that this song that we used to sing as a little boy has a newspaper. You remember those in the old days? The kids maybe in New York City would have a stack of newspapers and he'd be crying out, extra, extra, read all about it. That is the idea, okay? You guys remember this? Anybody remember this picture? Good news, good news. Christ died for me. Good news, good news. If I believe, good news, good news. I'm saved eternally. That's wonderful. Extra! Good news. That's what we learned so long ago. So, and that is the idea. That is good. That is the idea. A gospel is an announcement. It's right here. This is what has happened and what has been done. And it's good news, like it or not. It is objectively good news for the whole world. Even if you reject it, it's objectively good news. Because the news is that a righteous king, a king who laid down his life for the world, has risen from the dead, has ascended to the Father's right hand, and reigns as King of kings and Lord of lords. That is good news, whether we like it or not. Now, there's a thing in our culture. I hope none of you have received this, but what happens if a guy walks up with a letter in his hand and says, are you so-and-so? Yes, I am. They hand you this letter. And what do they say? You've been served. You've been served. Open it up and see what the news is. You're going to have to respond to it. That is gospeling. This is the news. You've been served. Now, it's not so impersonal. Normally, it's done and best done in the relation, context of a relationship where you know that you know them, they know that you love them, and so forth. But that's what it is. You've been served. Now you're going to have to respond to it. What are you going to do? It is faithfully delivering the message. Now, here, Paul has four clauses that describe the word, the gospel. First of all, he says, the gospel, the one which I gospeled. The same gospel that Paul received is the one that he hands on. This passage is full of this language. I received it. I handed it on to you. You received it. Now you hand it on. It's like this is the way that it's supposed to work all the way. This is how it came to Locust Grove. Somebody received it and they passed it on faithfully. He's the one who preached it to them as a faithful messenger. Secondly, the one you received. The good news made it to them through Paul's announcement. Paul is the source, the link in the chain to them. The one I gospeled, the one you received. That happened at a certain place in a certain time. The verb tense changes a little bit in this next one. It is the kind of tense that says, this happened and the results are ongoing. It's kind of like when you put your hand in the concrete when it's wet and you pull it out. That happened in a moment's time, but the result continues to the present time. And this is what he says, the one on which you have been made to stand. You took your stand on it, and you were still standing on it. It stood you up on solid ground, and they were still standing on it as their foundation for salvation. You're standing upon the solid rock of God's word. And then the one by which you are Notice this. What does the text say there? This gospel, the one by which you are being saved. Now, this is present tense. This is not something that has been accomplished yet. This is something that is ongoing, is in process. Most of the time in the New Testament, salvation is either a future thing, we will be saved, or it's an ongoing thing. You listen to me now. You are being saved. Same thing in chapter 1. The word of the cross is good news to those who are being saved. Seldom, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, it is past tense. By grace you have been saved, you were saved, but most of the time it is a present tense. You are being saved. I was saved. Well, is that right? Is that right? I am saved? Well, now listen to me. If I say, are you saved? What would you say? Well, I am being saved. I'm not saved yet, but I will be saved. Now think about this imagery of the children of Israel coming out of Egypt, going through the Red Sea, through the wilderness. Are they saved yet? Yes and no. They've come out of the slavery, but they've not yet entered into the promised land. In chapter 10, Paul is going to talk about this. So it is a gospel, is a message that is announced. That is the word. That is what it means, a euangelion. Hold on to that. Secondly, the whole word or the whole gospel. What is the gospel? I want you to notice that he does not say a gospel. This is some good news. There's other good news, but this is good news as well. It has the definite article, the gospel. Listen to me. There is one gospel. That's it. One and only one. The gospel. The one Paul talks about in Romans 1, 16 and 17. I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God. And there is no other power of God like this unto salvation for those who believe. Galatians chapter 1, 2 Corinthians 11. Paul says, there is only one gospel. And he says, in matter of fact, even if an angel from heaven comes down to you and announces to you another gospel, reject it if it's different than the one that you've already received. There is one gospel. And to sum it all up, what is the gospel? Jesus is king. Who's in charge around here? Who is the authority? Jesus is king. I want you to say that out loud. Can you confess that with your mouth? Jesus is king. King. That's what Jesus Christ means, the anointed one, the Messiah. Jesus is king. Who's in charge these days, folks? Jesus is the king, whether we like it or not, whether anybody likes it or not. He is in charge. He is the king. In verse 3 and following, Paul lays out exactly what the gospel is. And the gospel is the whole story of the saving life, death, resurrection, ascension of Jesus Christ. Most of the time, many times in the New Testament, when it says the word you received is talking specifically about the gospel, not the whole Bible, although the whole Bible leads up to and reflects upon the gospel. Now, I think, actually, the gospel goes all the way through verse 28, so we'll get there in just a minute. What is the gospel by which they are being saved, by which we are being saved? Now, when Paul thinks about the gospel, it's clear in Corinthians that his mind goes back to the Exodus. Okay, he thinks about what does it mean to be saved? What is the imagery that we can latch onto there? You remember the story with Moses, the plagues, the children of Israel coming out of Egypt? He thinks it's the lamb in the Exodus. Chapter 5, verse 7, Paul says, Christ is our paschal lamb. Our Passover lamb has been sacrificed. He's thinking about that lamb. Do you remember what did they do? They sacrificed a lamb without blemish. They took its blood. And they put it on the doorposts around their door. They applied the blood so that the angel of destruction would pass over them, would know that they are covered by the blood. And this is what Paul is thinking about. What does it mean to be saved? We've escaped the wrath of God. We've escaped destruction. And so he says, Jesus died for our sins. Listen to me. What is salvation these days? What does it mean to be saved? If it doesn't deal with the sin problem that each of us has, it isn't salvation. It's not good news if it doesn't deal with our sin.
Now, Paul does not say how Jesus' death deals with our sin. He doesn't tell us the mechanics. It works like this, A, B, and C. He simply says, the death of Jesus, his blood being shed on the cross, was for our sins so that we have forgiveness of sins. Jesus' death was in our place and for our good. He protects us from the wrath that we deserve because of our sins. So again, think of the death of the unblemished lamb. Can you imagine in your mind's eye right now that humble Hebrew dwelling with the blood applied around the door of each home to protect them from the destroying angel? Think of them marching out of slavery, the slavery of sin, through the waters of baptism. And what did they do when they reached the other side of the sea? They sang a song of salvation. It ended in praise to God. Jesus, Paul said, is our Passover lamb whose blood has been shed and applied. Has his blood been applied to your life so that God might pass over you and bring you into salvation? It has been shed and applied to protect us from the death that is coming for all who are not covered. Remember that this was an act of faith for the Hebrews. Put yourself in their shoes, okay? They've heard this is what you're supposed to do. Kill a lamb, apply the blood to your doorpost, and then what's going to happen? It was an act of faith. What if that night no angel of death showed up? Now you have been marked for all of the Egyptians to see just which side that you're on. They did this in faith. It would be easy now for the Egyptians to identify everyone who had bet against them and he was ready to march out of the land that blood had soaked into the door frame and dried. Easy to identify. So it was an act of faith. We're putting our trust, our faith in the Word of God to save us. Second, it says he was buried. Jesus really died and was buried. The heart of the Son of God stopped pumping blood. The blood stilled, stopped circulating. The brain waves stilled. The body grew cold and pale and rigid. This happened to Jesus for us. But on the third day, he rose again. This is what Paul says. This is my gospel. This is my gospel. In chapter 15, Paul is showing that the bodily resurrection. I want you to grab a hold of your other hand. Can you do that for just a moment? I want you to feel your other hand. Do you feel your other hand? That hand is going to last forever and ever and ever. Bodily resurrection. Our hope is not to die, to be put in the ground, and my spirit to go be with the Lord forever. Our hope is just as Jesus was raised from the dead bodily, that this body that's wearing out is going to be raised from the dead, is going to be resurrected. And if I die before Jesus comes back, my spirit is going to be reunited with this body, and I'll rise to meet the Lord in the air. Raised on the third day is a necessary part of the gospel. We are pitiful creatures, Paul says, if Christ has not been raised. If there's no resurrection, there's no gospel, there's no hope, there's no forgiveness, but the tomb is empty. And he has risen bodily. Now let me ask you a question. Where is Jesus right now? Well, Paul said, after he was raised, it's not just that there was an empty tomb. He was seen by flesh and blood eyes like I have. And he goes down the list of all the people who saw him. Peter and James and the rest of the apostles. And 500 people at one time saw him. And he says, If you don't believe me, go ask them. Many of them are still alive right now. Go ask them. They'll all tell you they saw Jesus alive. And then finally, he says, finally, me. Last, the last and the least, I saw him alive. As one born abortively. It was a strange timing for me to be born, but he appeared to me and it changed everything in Paul's life. And then what happened after he was seen? This is the gospel, folks. He ascended. I want you to look at verse 20 and following. Now, his ascension is assumed here. We fast forward and raise our eyes toward heaven. He's talking about the resurrection and what that means. Each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits. That is, Jesus rose from the dead first, and the rest of us are going to follow. And after that, those who are Christ's at his coming. Then comes what? The end, when he hands over the kingdom to God our Father, and when he has abolished all rule, all authority and all power, for he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. I want you to understand that right now, what is going on in this world is all of the enemies of Christ are being defeated and placed under his feet right now. Now, you may not see that that's happening. We have to have eyes of faith to know that the gospel is prevailing throughout the world. The last enemy that will be abolished is death, for he has put all things in subjection under his feet. This is good news. When he says all things are put in subjection, it's clear this excludes the Father, of course. The Father is not put in subjection to Jesus. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to the one who subjected all things to him. So the Father is now for Christ, defeating all powers as Jesus reigns. They're placed under Jesus' feet. And when all is said and done, Jesus is going to hand the kingdom over to the Father. And God is going to be, listen, all in all, total, utter, complete victory. Nothing left but righteousness and goodness and peace. No more death, no more sin, no more trials, no more sickness, no more hospitals, no more chemotherapy, no more vaccinations, no more viruses, no more bacteria, no more parting, no more heartache. All of that will be gone, and the God who is good will be all in all. That's good news. That's good news. It's the greatest news you could ever hear. And he says here that Jesus is reigning and gaining. I got a little bit ahead of myself here. Jesus is reigning and gaining. It's easy to get excited about this. All of his enemies under his feet, so that the end of the story is glory. The end of the story is glory. I have a couple of slides there to kind of some graphics to show you. So he says, the wrong shall fail, the right shall prevail. This is the good news. There's no greater story to tell. Jesus is king. And then Paul says it a couple of times. Did you notice he said, according to the scriptures? According to the scriptures. This was foreseen. Jesus wasn't only seen, but this was foreseen. All of these things that have happened were prophesied from the very beginning. When God said that there would be enmity between the woman and her seed and between the serpent and his seed, and you will strike his heel, but he will crush your head. From the very beginning, it is all the scriptures have been pointing forward to this moment. Jesus died on the cross for the sins of the world, crushed the head of that serpent, our great enemy. And then the rest of the story, he says, is that the tomb is empty. That he was seen. Go ahead to the next slide there. That he was seen. And Jesus is king forever and ever. We get excited about news sometimes. Hey, this happened, this happened. Did you see who the Cubs got? The Cubs got this pitcher. They get excited about that kind of thing, you know. We get excited about telling the greatest news, the good news, announcing it. Coming to faith is coming to grips with the fact that Jesus is, in fact, Lord of all. That's what it means. Submitting myself to the... One can rebel in vain, Psalm 2. The nations rebel. They want to throw off the chains and the shackles against this fact. Or you can joyfully embrace and celebrate this good news that the Lord of all is the one who gave his life for all of us. So it's a comprehensive story according to the scriptures. Which ones? All of them. That's why the Gospel of John begins by saying, in the beginning... Goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 1, because the story of Jesus begins in the beginning. Luke chapter 24, it says that when Jesus was walking along with the travelers on the road to Emmaus, he began with Moses and he went all the way through the Bible. Can you imagine what a Bible lesson that must have been? To walk with those travelers on the road to Emmaus as the resurrected Jesus teaches them and shows them how all the scriptures had pointed forward to him. According to the scriptures. So the question is not whether or not Jesus is Lord. The only question is, have you confessed with your mouth that he is Lord? So, you've heard the gospel. Everybody in here, you have been served. What are you going to do with this good news? That's the question. This is my last point, and whether we like it or not, it is one of Paul's points. I want to tell you here in just a second, I'm going to go back there, and there's a baptism today. And it is going to be a time of great rejoicing. It is going to be a time of great rejoicing. And we've already been rejoicing. with this family. And Randy's going to be baptized. Next week, Lord willing, he's going to take communion. Praise God for that. There's also a warning in this passage. Paul says to the Corinthians that had so many problems, he says, I make known to you, and then skip down to verse 2, in what words I preached to you. Listen to me, beloved, please. In what words I preached to you. In other words, I preached the gospel in a very particular and specific way that can't be changed. And I want to make and to remind you, you've heard this before because you received it from me. But I'm making known to you again here at the end of this letter, in what words I preached to you, if you hold fast to it, unless you believed to no purpose. What Paul received, he passed on to them. They do not have a choice to change it or alter it. For if they alter it, then it is no longer it. He says, with what words? Now, it's not to be taken narrowly as if it's an incantation or a spell. You have to say it just right. But the content of the gospel is what he's talking about. What I just laid out a moment ago. Again, he says, you cannot modify it. You cannot add to it. You cannot subtract from it. It is what it is, and we must face the fact of it. We receive it as it is. Hold fast to it as it is. We are not potters fashioning the gospel as we see fit. We are the clay being shaped by the truth of it. The gospel, he says, the way that I passed it on to you, not just as you might want it to be. St. Augustine, I quoted this not too long ago, but he says, if you believe what you like in the gospel and reject what you don't like, it's not the gospel you believe, but yourself. Can't be changed. Notice he says, unless you believe to no purpose. Now, no purpose here, some translations, it's translated in vain. It's not the same word that's translated in vain in the rest of the chapter. It says, the grace of God to me was not in vain. At the end of the chapter, he ends by saying, be steadfast, always abounding in the work of the Lord, because your faith in God, in the Lord, is not in vain. This is a different word, and it means to no purpose. It doesn't have any effect. And he says you should hold fast. Otherwise, it's unless you believed to no purpose. And so these are opposites, and they complement one another. The negative, unless you believed in vain. The positive, hold fast to it. Do you see that? You can't change it. You got to hold on to it. Now listen to me. I know that there's all kinds of new teaching out there, and these people who are saying they discovered new things and whatever. I really don't care which theologian or which professor or which teacher or preacher discovers that we've gotten the gospel wrong all along after all. And now we know that, for instance, we know now that resurrection is not possible, so we're going to have to change the gospel. I don't care who says it, reject it. Eugene Peterson translates it, verse 15, actually it's verse 2, chapter 15. I'm assuming now that your belief was the real thing and not a passing fancy, that you're in this for good and holding fast. This is a warning. 2 Corinthians 13:5, beloved, he says, test yourselves to see if you're in the faith. To the same church. Examine yourselves. 1 Corinthians has a number of warnings. Chapter 6, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? And he goes through and lists all these people who will not inherit the kingdom of God. In chapter 10, he says, I want you to know, or I don't want you to be ignorant, brothers, that our fathers, now underline this in your Bible, all were under the cloud. This is chapter 10. All passed through the sea. All were baptized into Moses. These are the people that came out of the bondage of Egypt. They came through the Red Sea. They came into the wilderness. God provided for them. They all, verse 3, ate the same supernatural food. They all drank the same supernatural drink. They drank from the supernatural rock which followed them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, look at verse 5. All came out, were fed. Nevertheless, with most of them, God was not pleased. For they were scattered, strewn in the wilderness. This is a warning again. The Corinthians were in danger of falling into idolatry. And Paul says, look, don't be presumptuous about your salvation. Remember that those who came to the Red Sea, all but two, died in the wilderness. They never made it to the promised land. I don't like these verses any more than you do. I don't like them, but they're here in God's word as a warning to us. Not to assume about our salvation, to be presumptuous, even though he wants us to have assurance. And so, verse 6, now these things are warnings for us not to desire evil as they did. Skip down to verse 12. Therefore, let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed lest he fall. Now remember chapter 15, verse 2. This gospel, on which you stand. He's already said in chapter 10, if you think you stand, be careful that you don't fall. Remember what happened to them. So this Exodus imagery of being baptized, receiving the supernatural drink and food, so we're baptized, we come to the Lord's table and receive all of this. They have been baptized. They've received the Lord's Supper, chapter 11. But they still have to be careful. They were being saved. They were being saved. They were shielded and protected, and God provided manna and water in the wilderness. But they were not saved till they entered into the promised land. This is a warning for us. So our Father wants us to have assurance, but not to be presumptuous. Now I have no doubt that Brother Randy has grasped, listen to me, has grasped the gospel, the true gospel, and that God has grabbed a hold of him. I don't have any doubt. But the proof for all of us, Paul says, is in the perseverance. Proof is in the perseverance. Do we make it all the way home? Now, I'm not going to go through this. The big issues in 1 Corinthians that threaten them in terms of stumbling, sexual immorality, he says in chapter 6, flee from sexual immorality, and idolatry. He says, flee from idolatry. That is, there a danger of turning back to those old things, those old patterns of life, which threaten our relationship to the Lord. And so in chapter 10, he says, God gives us a way of escape. Let me finish up in this way. That is the warning. I've said more about it than I want to, but it's here so that we might take heed. But I want you to notice what Paul says about grace. Paul says, I give you this gospel of first importance, this gospel of grace. I give it to you as first importance, although he is the last and he is the least. How is it that this persecutor of the church ends up being a herald of the gospel? How is it? Well, it's by grace. Let me read these verses again and just remind you, even in the context of warning, it is all about the grace of God, continuing in faith to believe upon him. For he says, I'm the least of the apostles and not fit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. Can you say that with me? By the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me did not prove in vain. But I labored even more than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God that is within me. You've been served. Are you being saved? I wonder if there's somebody here with your heads bowed and eyes closed as we finish the service, as we prepare for baptism. I wonder if there's someone here, maybe for the first time you've heard the gospel clearly and the Spirit of God has spoken to your heart and you know that you need to come. Come home to the one who died for your sins. Maybe there's someone here that the Spirit of God is convicting you. Maybe there was a time when walked an aisle or said something happened to me. But God is telling me today to repent, to confess, to truly embrace, fully embrace the gospel of grace so that I might rely upon his grace, standing firmly upon the true gospel all the days of my life. There may be somebody here like that. And you know that you need to come as we've heard the warning and as we've heard the invitation. do you need to come? Father in heaven, we're thankful for the salvation through your Son, our Lord Jesus. I pray that your Spirit would work powerfully among us. If there's someone here today who needs to come home, I pray that they would come. In Jesus' name, would you stand with me as Les sings, Jesus is still mighty to save. Do you need to come? The altars are open. One more time. He is able.
He is able. Christ is able. Sinners, come sinners, poor and needy, sing to him.
I'm going to go prepare for baptism. Les is going to lead you in singing as we prepare. Continue to sing and to worship and to prepare your hearts.
Let's sing that last verse together.
In the stillness of the morning, in the quiet of the dawn, praise will rise as darkness scatters and our song goes on and on. He is able, he is able, Christ is able still.
get too close. Friday, went by to see Randy and Donna. We make a good pair here, don't we? And Sister Donna's mother, Helen, has passed away and gone to be with the Lord. And the week before, on a Friday, I'd come by to see Donna and the family. She and Ashley were not there in Brooklyn. Only Randy was home. And I believe that was providential, because he and I had a chance to talk about the Lord, to talk about how much Jesus loves us, to talk about how Jesus died for our sins, and how he's calling on us, inviting us to confess with our mouths that Jesus is Lord. And we had a prayer together, and I know that we could both sense the Lord's presence there, and on his goodness and grace and kindness. And didn't make a decision that day, but I said, can I come back next Friday and visit with you? And he said, yes. Well, I came back the next Friday. I asked Randy if I could share this story, which was just a couple days ago. And Donna was there, and Brooklyn was there. Brooklyn had a lot on her mind. She's a precious child of God. And we talked for a while about Donna and losing your mother and what that's like and the difficulty. And I turned to Randy and I said, Randy, are you ready? He didn't hesitate one bit. He said, yes, I'm ready.
Amen.
I believe Donna just about hit the roof. I don't think she saw that coming. Never heard, seen anybody spring from a chair that quickly before. And we hugged and we cried tears of joy. And we just thought about how the angels of heaven, I told little Brooklyn, the angels of heaven are rejoicing right now, as Jesus teaches us in Luke chapter 15. And we knelt down there and we all cried and prayed together. And Jesus came into Brother Randy's heart.
Amen.
Sins washed away, made white as snow. And I know God is going to do great things in Randy's life and through his life. I'm so thankful he's my brother in Christ. And it's an honor to be able to baptize him today.
Amen.
Come on down here, Randy.
Amen.
That's going to be a new tradition here. You get a high five from Les before you're baptized. I'm thankful that all these years, Sister Donna has lived just a faithful Christian life in a sweetness and a kindness and a holiness and a goodness. And she doesn't want any glory for any of this, but this is what God's Word says to do in 1 Peter chapter 3. If you have a husband that doesn't know the Lord, just
Stay at it.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, Randy, by God's grace, in God's good time, by his patience and mercy and love for you, you've come to know God as your Father through Jesus Christ your Savior. You've been filled with the Holy Spirit. And because of your profession of faith and in obedience to the divine command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and of the Son. So shine before all people that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine down upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Go and proclaim.